News 12 is brought to you by Kenneth Nugent. From the station that's on your side, this is News 12, First at 5.
A federal judge says South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham must appear in court to testify, but his camp says the law is on their side. We'll explain in just a moment. And the school year has officially started for another round of our local students. Today was the first day in Aiken County, and we love seeing all your back-to-school photos. Lots of smiles, and for some, it's their first day ever. For some, it's their first last day. No matter what day this is for you, all of us here at News 12 hope you have a great year. And parents, we know a lot of you have a lot of questions when it comes to cell phones. When and where can my child use one in school? We've heard teachers in other counties are doubling down on cell phone policies this year. So today, our Nick Veland is doing the homework for you.
Today was Aiken County School District's first day of school. Now that student summers are over, policies will limit student cell phone time. The district tells us when in class or in the hallways, no phone usage is allowed. Students can only bring their phones out at lunch. The only exception is outlined on their website, saying that this policy is exempted for documented medical needs, physical or academic accommodations, or other legitimate reasons as approved in writing by the school. With all public schools in the area being back, News 12 did some digging on other personal device policies. For Richmond County, their student code of conduct calls the use of mobile devices or personal computers a privilege, only allowed for school curriculum-based activities, with having to follow guidelines outlined in the student code of conduct, like not using the devices to bully or harass, electronically capturing the image of others without express permission, and others. For Columbia County, teachers' permission will allow you to bring in your own technology when it will supplement and assist learning in the classroom, and not having these devices won't put you behind. So basically, that can be different from class to class and school to school. Reporting in Augusta, I'm Nick Veland on your side.
Also in Columbia County, school supply lists that included calculators specifically said smartphones cannot be used instead. It has to be an actual calculator. Your best bet, no matter what county you're in, ask your child's teacher what their policy is. Meanwhile, we are getting ready for a wet and sticky week,
I have an update on that wet week ahead in just about 10 minutes.
All right, thanks for that, Riley. New First at 5, Georgia's heartbeat law, or the 6-week abortion ban, will stand. The Superior Court of Fulton County decided not to place an injunction on the law while a lawsuit challenging the ban's constitutionality makes its way through the courts. Georgia's 6-week abortion ban was challenged shortly after Governor Brian Kemp signed it into law in 2019, but it had been blocked because it was making its way through the federal courts, that is, until Roe v. Wade was overturned this summer. This challenge came in state court after that, but again, today's decision allows the ban on abortions to stand. A Fort Stewart soldier's death is under investigation tonight. Private First Class Denisha Montgomery was found unresponsive in her barracks last Tuesday while deployed in Germany. She was pronounced dead on scene. The U.S. Army Criminal Investigation Division is now looking into what happened. Montgomery was scheduled to return home next month. Federal law enforcement agents and their families now on high alert after a new warning about an increase in threats. This after the FBI search of former President Donald Trump's Florida home. Meanwhile, as Alice Barr reports, leaders are calling for more information on the classified documents seized at Mar-a-Lago.
High-profile sites on high alert across the country amid a spike in threats against federal law enforcement, government, and judicial officials.
You're seeing open calls for violence and death threats against targeted individuals.
The FBI and Homeland Security warning of calls for violence circulating online following the search of former President Trump's Mar-a-Lago home last week. Court documents show FBI agents seized 11 sets of top secret and other highly classified documents.
Once those documents leave the White House, once they leave a government facility, they are incredibly vulnerable to any foreign adversary that wants to get their hands on them.
While some Trump loyalists accuse the FBI of overreach, other Republicans are calling for a loyalty check.
The GOP is going to be the party of supporting law enforcement. Law enforcement includes the FBI.
with calls to justify the search growing louder.
Show that this was not just a fishing expedition.
The top Democrat and Republican on the Senate Intelligence Committee are now pushing for a full list of the documents found and an assessment of any national security risk resulting from their mishandling. The former president and his allies suggesting he declassified anything taken from the White House, but his former national security advisor, John Bolton, refutes that.
I think that claim is almost certainly a lie.
Noting he knows of no paper trail to back that up and alleging former President Trump was careless with sensitive documents. In Washington, Alice Barr, NBC News.
Also new today, a group of congressional Republicans sent letters to the Justice Department, FBI, and White House telling them to preserve documents about the Mar-a-Lago search, signaling that they might want evidence for an investigation of their own. We'll keep watching. Senator Lindsey Graham must testify before a special grand jury in Atlanta. That is the word today from a federal judge after he was a no-show last week. The investigation is looking to see if then-President Donald Trump and his allies broke any laws while trying to overturn the 2020 general election loss. Last week, before he did not go to court, this is what Senator Graham had to say.
This is ridiculous. This weaponization of the law needs to stop. So I will use the courts, and we'll go as far as we need to go.
Attorneys for Senator Graham are arguing his position as a U.S. senator provided him immunity from having to appear before the investigative panel and asked the judge to squash his subpoena. But today, that request was also overturned. This was the criminal defense attorney on the case and what they had to say about it.
Senator Graham, I think, has already indicated through his office that they're going to continue to challenge this. If so, they have to seek permission to challenge it in front of the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals, which is here in Atlanta.
Senator Graham's subpoena is now telling him to appear before the special grand jury on August 23rd. Meanwhile, lawyers for Rudy Giuliani say he's been named a target in that same election probe. Georgia prosecutors initially told New York courts Giuliani was a material witness, but today they said otherwise. Last week, Giuliani was ordered to testify in person this Wednesday. His attorneys say he still plans to show up in court. Congressman James Clyburn and the U.S. Secretary of Education, Miguel Cardona, are meeting with students in South Carolina today. They're getting feedback on pandemic recovery. One discussion is how students have been assisted by the Higher Education Emergency Relief Fund. In addition to hearing from students, they will also be listening to leaders at historically black colleges and universities. HBCUs across the state received more than $112 million in funding thanks to the American Rescue Plan. Here was the U.S. Secretary of Education and what he had to say about graduate funding that will be helped with all of this.
Higher education funding for HBCUs, which, as the congressman mentioned, has been underfunded for years. So at the federal level, there's a level of urgency. We want to see that urgency matched at the state level.
In 2021, the Biden administration dedicated $5.8 billion nationwide to HBCUs. The Richmond County Marshal's Office introducing a new member to the team. This is their new K-9, Lexi, short for Alexandra. Lexi got hired since their other K-9, Abby, is getting close to retirement. Lexi and her handler, Deputy Jonathan Harvey, will be spending the next few weeks in training. We wish Deputy Harvey and Lexi the best of luck. Man's best friend and now Marshall's best friend. One man's hobby could have him paying thousands of dollars in fines. We'll explain in just a few moments, Riley.
Well, we have stayed mostly dry today, but we are tracking a cold front that will continue our storm chances even into tonight. I'm looking at that full forecast just after the break.
A rabid raccoon is dead after being killed by a Richmond County neighborhood dog. They say the incident happened on Piedmont Street back on August 7th. After the attack, they did send the raccoon off for testing. And then that's when it came back positive for rabies. Just a reminder, make sure your pets are vaccinated. Don't let them roam free. This this one of those reminders why it is so important that we keep up with those annual appointments for our pets, Riley. Absolutely. I know that it's so important.
But those high temperatures do look to stay in the 80s for the next 5 to 7 days.
All right, thank you, Riley. A recent magnet fishing trip at Fort Stewart has left one man and his team in hot water. Now they're facing thousands of dollars in fines, despite the fact that they have prior permission. Flynn Snyder explains.
Magnet fisherman Bryce Knockway says it's not uncommon for him and his team to find firearms and other types of weapons in area waters, but it was the reaction of law enforcement during a recent trip near Fort Stewart that really caught him by surprise.
A usual day of magnet fishing for Bryce Knockway means reeling in some very unusual finds.
I got a found! Is it a military phone?
During a recent trip to Fort Stewart, Knockway says his magnets pulled in ammo belts, rockets, tracer rounds.
And then we ended up finding a Delta Airlines duffel bag stuffed full of those rockets.
We first introduced you to Knockway, who casts magnets in waterways back in June. That's around the same time he took the trip to Fort Stewart and discovered the rockets and reported the findings to law enforcement.
Well, at first it was all right, and then it took a turn for the worse a little later on when the game warning came out.
Y'all getting tickets, man?
We getting tickets?
Yeah.
Fort Stewart law enforcement cited the team for recreating without a permit, entering a restricted area, and unauthorized magnet detecting.
Because we called the DNR before we went out to make sure we were, like, all good to do it. And they're like, as long as you're in a green zone, you're all good. We looked on the map, and we were in a green zone.
In response, Fort Stewart officials say magnet detecting is not allowed on their property. The statement continues to say that because Fort Stewart is an active installation, there is always a potential for unexploded ordnance to end up in the nearby river. Knockway says that's news to him because up until now, he's magnet fished just about anywhere.
Anywhere with a no trespassing sign, pretty much. But don't do it on Fort Stewart.
Knockway and his team say they have court dates set in September, which they do plan on attending to dispute those citations. We're back in a bit.
The live by camera.
Prices in town. Visit us at Davis Appliance and Furniture.
The federal government is cracking down on hospitals that aren't complying with new pricing transparency laws. Many hospitals across the country still are not following the rules. Susan Campbell explains.
This law went into effect last year. It requires hospitals to post a comprehensive list of the cost of items and services, and it has to be in a consumer-friendly format. In June, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services issued 2 civil penalties for hospitals in Georgia, totaling more than $1 million for not complying with the law. And the agency says it will continue to investigate hospitals around the country to make sure consumers have all the information they need.
You need a knee replacement. Not an emergency surgery, so you have time to shop around for the care that works best for you. Of course, the cost could play a part in that decision.
Price transparency in healthcare is truly transformative. Why? It's because it shifts the power to the consumer to be well informed of all prices in healthcare in advance of getting their care.
Cynthia Fisher is the founder and chairman of Patient Rights Advocate, a nonpartisan nonprofit. According to the group's most recent hospital price transparency compliance report, only 14.3% of hospitals were in compliance, often because of missing or incomplete information. The hospital's websites were evaluated in December and January.
They're supposed to post the actual prices by discounting cash price, as well as every single negotiated rate they have for care by every insurance carrier and every health plan. The only way we can get to a competitive and honest and fair functional marketplace is to have actual prices. Everyone knows estimates don't work.
Now, consumers should have even more pricing information available to them. Beginning July 1st, most group health plans and issuers of group or individual health insurance are required to disclose pricing.
This is amazing because this is system-wide healthcare price transparency getting unleashed. So for the first time, the hospital price transparency rule and the insurance price transparency rule together make both hospitals and insurance companies have to compete. And they're going to have to compete on quality and price for our hard-earned healthcare dollars.
If you
you don't see prices listed, you can submit a complaint to the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services at cms.gov. I'm Susan Campbell.